Hello everyone and welcome to our new live webcast, a shelter to protect your documents. Each month, join us for new powerful messages, technical tips and success stories that will leave you inspired and ready to get your protection, licensing and security techniques another step closer to perfection. My name is Daniela Previtali, Global Marketing Director of IBUS Systems, and I am delighted to have you here with us today. We are joined by Rüdiger Kügler, VP Sales and Security Expert of IBUS Systems, and Stefan Bamberg, Senior Key Account and Partner Manager of IBUS Systems. Our hosts have a memorable program waiting for you and are going to be talking about the protection of the intellectual property associated with digital assets that come in a form other than software applications. This goal requires a different approach and dedicated tools. While CodeMeter Protection Suite protects software against illicit actions, Smart Shelter PDF, Smart Shelter SDL, and CodeMeter Core API are here to protect and license your digital documents. Some housekeeping we need to take care of before we start. For everyone who's joining us today, I want to remind you that we will be reserving some time at the end of the session for Q&A. And I'd like to invite you to submit any question you have in the live chat room. This session is being recorded and a link to the replay will be posted directly to you in a couple of days. And don't forget, stay with us throughout the live session for your chance to win an Amazon coupon worth 50 euro. At the end of the webinar, a pop-up window with three simple quiz questions will show up. You can submit one choice for each multiple answer question. We will draw the winner from among those who reply correctly and notify them at the time of the replay announcement. Please also note that the winner is excluded from all subsequent prize draws of 2017. Without further ado, I'll pass things over to Rüdiger. The floor is yours.
Hello everybody, my name is Stefan Bamberg. I'm here with my colleague Rüdiger Kügler and we want to show you today in our webinar how to protect documents. So let's start first with a comparison between the encryption of applications versus documents to give you an impression how that works in principle. So let's see if we have normal application, an executable for example in the Windows. You have a code section, a data section, a resource section. You use our tool AX Protector to encrypt the whole application and you see all the sections are encrypted with a key and the so-called AX engine is added to the application as well so that you have at the end of the day a self-extracting, self-decrypting application if the correct license is available on the system. But how does it work on documents?
Yeah, okay, so hello also from my side, Rüdiger Kügler here. And we have seen on this applications that we changed the original entry point. And so now when we have an application instead of the original code, now our code is started first and our code checks license there, yes, no. And if it is there, then the rest will be decrypted. But in difference to this application, in case of a document, we have a document header and we have some data, but there is no executable code. And so what we can do is we also can take AX Protector. We will see this later in a sample. And we will encrypt a complete document and we will place our own VBO header at the top of the document. But of course, there's no executable code in a document. If there would be executable code, this would be some sort of virus. And so very strange. And so that's why the difference between a document and an application is an application can self-decrypt itself, but a document cannot do this. And so you need some application, some tool, some viewer, some app, which does this work for the document. And so, just as you see here, the encrypted application has this decryption, self-decryption engine, and document not. And so, the application self-decrypts. And in contrary to this, the document needs someone, somebody, another application, which decrypts this document. And so, just a short summary. AX Protector encrypts all sections, so code, text, and also resources and data section. And AX Protector inserts or appends the decrypting code, so our AX engine. We modify, as told, the original entry point and saying, okay, please now first execute the self-extracting code, the AX engine, and then the application is still executable, of course. And in contrary to this, the document is completely encrypted. It has its own header at the beginning of the document, but we need some other application to decrypt the document and, of course, to recognize first that the document is encrypted and then to decrypt. And if you take a look at this document protection, then we see there are a lot of different use cases. The first use case is you have a PDF document, which is very widely used, and so PDF document protection is a very big topic. Stefan will come to this in the next seconds. The next thing is I have some standard documents like XML files, audio files, video files, Word documents. Then we also see the limitations of this technology, or it's not really a technical limitation, it's more a business case limitation, because from a technical point of view, but I don't want to tell you everything now. Let's wait for this later. And last but not least, your own documents, your own files. Let's assume you're a machine vendor and you have a laser cutting machine and you need some NC files, which shows how to use the laser, so which shapes to cut from the things. And so we have this type of document, and you want to protect this type of document, so your own documents. And so these are the three parts of our webinar. First, PDF, standard documents, and then your own documents. But Stefan, how does PDF protection work?
Yeah, let's have a closer look to that. So if you want to protect such a document, a PDF document, you need a few things. So first of all, you need our Smart Shelter PDF product, which is part of the Code Media Technology package. And you need an Adobe Acrobat for that. Together with the Smart Shelter PDF author and our firm security box, you are able to protect, encrypt documents. And maybe you know such a license consists of firm code. This is a worldwide unique key dedicated to your company, and a product code that you can choose by your own. And if you use this technology, and we see that in a demonstration later, you get a protected PDF file that can only be opened if you have the right license available on your system. So Smart Shelter PDF relies on the native encryption mechanism from Adobe Acrobat. So we are using the built-in mechanism of Adobe Acrobat. This is a symmetric AES key, 256-bit. Maybe you know you can add a password to such a document, and that means that the document is encrypted in that way. And the password that is created by the Smart Shelter PDF plugin for this encryption mechanism. It is invisible to the user, and thus it is impossible to copy it. It derived from the firm code and product code that are stored in our secure anchor. Maybe that's a dongle or that's a software activation. And it has a high entropy and therefore secure against brute force attacks. And since we have our security expert Rüdiger here at the desk, I think he will add something to that.
Okay, so Stefan told us that we will use the native encryption of Adobe PDF, but I've seen a lot of password cracking program, so just downloading this cracking program, taking a PDF file, and then I want to crack the password, and it's quite easy to crack. And so the question is, if you're using this mechanism, is it really secure? And I say, yes, it is, because the mechanism implemented by Adobe is really good, but the problem is the human, which is using this this mechanism, because humans mostly like to take passwords which are convenient for them, and so short passwords like the name of the daughter, the name of the dog, the name of the husband, the name of the wife. By the way, maybe I should check some passwords, but okay, other thing. Yes, and so humans are choosing short passwords. And that's the reason why this password cracking tools will work, because they try every password starting with one letter, two letters, three letters, four letters, and so on. And what we are creating is a real long and real strong password, and so there's no way to test and check every possible combination if the password is long enough. And that's the reason why Smart Shelter PDF together with Adobe is secure, but Adobe alone is mostly insecure because the humans are using too short passwords.
Yes, and entropy, high entropy means here in that case that we have upper case letters, lower case letters, numbers, and special signs as well. So Smart Shelter PDF also detects unwanted programs, so we take care if there is a screenshot program, for example, in the memory or a debugger in the memory, then we will close the document immediately. And Smart Shelter PDF supports all CodeMeter product item options, which means it supports all license models that we have available with our technology, starting with a single user license, a network license, time limited licenses. All of them are supported, depends on the product item options you set for such a product code. And Smart Shelter supports all the security features of Adobe Acrobat, and we will see that in the demo later. So now let's change the roles. You have protected your document, and now the document is delivered to the customer. What does the customer need to open such a protected PDF file? And here we use the Adobe Acrobat Reader, and he needs plugin, the Smart Shelter PDF Reader plugin, and of course he needs the appropriate license. In this example here is the firm code 10 and product code 1000 that has to be available on the system so that the customer can open the protected file and see the content of such a file. So Smart Shelter PDF verifies if a valid license is available, and valid license means exactly the license that you have used to encrypt the document. The customer needs a corresponding license to decrypt such a document. Smart Shelter PDF generates a decryption password. Of course, the user is not aware of the used password. It is transferred on an API from the Adobe Acrobat Reader. The document is decrypted in the memory at the end. So Smart Shelter PDF is on the alert for unwanted programs. That's the same thing that I've shown before. And it is ready to close the PDF file immediately if any of these programs are detected. And last but not least, the Smart Shelter PDF provides an interface for customized error dialogues, because if you don't have an appropriate license, you get the error message, hey, there is no license for opening this document, you need to get one from the customer. And at the end, Smart Shelter PDF of course supports all CodeMeter product item options as well. So let's see how that works in reality. So I have here my Adobe Acrobat, and you can see here is the icon of our plugin, and if you push that button, then you get the Smart Shelter PDF dialog. And you see here I've used the firm code 6010, the new universal firm code that Weebo Systems offers today, and the product code 201,000, that's a number that I have decided to protect my document with. You can also see I have the possibility to use network license, to allow network licenses. I can use the product item option unit counter. I can say, okay, this document can only be opened 10 times, for example. You can use the time-based licenses, so it checks for expiration date or usage period. That's all license models, product item options that can be set and checked by our plugin. If you want to set permissions, then you push the set button here, and then you get some options that allow you to, for example, avoid printing, avoid changes of the document. You can say, okay, I want to disable screenshots in the middle of the dialog box. You can say only open an Adobe Reader, not in another Adobe Acrobat. And you can, of course, say, I want to use a debugger check to make sure that no debugger is in the system when the document is opened.
And what we see here in this dialogue is that we have a mixture of security features provided already by Adobe, like the sprinting allowed and changes allowed, and the security features which we added as on top security, like this advanced debugger check or this disabling screenshot tools, this checking if some unwanted programs like the screenshotting programs, Snagit for example, that they are detected and the document is closed before the user can create a screenshot. And so it's a mixture of Adobe features and our add-on security features.
Yes, and we have the next tab here. This is the plain text passwords. You remember we are creating really good passwords for the Adobe Acrobat, and you can see here passwords that are created by our system. And the next tab shows the possibility to add an own error message DLL that allows you to capture the error messages and maybe to transfer the customer to a page where he can buy or get some licenses to be able to open the document. So if that all is done, if the customer has no license available, then he sees such an error message. This is a simple error message. You can change that, of course. And if he has a license, then he's able to open the document without any limitations. Okay, how about standard documents in a viewer?
Okay, so let's take a look at a second use case. I have an XML file, or I have some, let's say, Navisworks files that I want to hand over to a customer. I want to maybe sell it to a customer, or this is my intellectual property and I want to give it to only authorized registered users. And so I want to control who is available to open and view this document. So and here we have our technology, which we call Smart Shelter SDL, SDL for Secure Data Layer. And this is integrated in our AX Protector. And so what we have here, we have a text file, video file, audio file, XML file. And then we take, as I told you, it's integrated in our AX Protector. We take AX Protector and we take our master key, our firm security box, the same key that we already used for Smart Shelter PDF. So it's a key, master key with your root key so that you can create licenses, sign licenses, and of course you can encrypt some data, some documents, and of course some applications. And here we define, okay, we want to use firm code 10, our firm code, and I just choose product code 1000 for this document. And then I get an encrypted file, audio, video, text, or XML. So and that's what we already saw. We take the document, including header and data, and we encrypt the whole document. And we add our Vibu header on top of the document. So this is already an already seen picture. And just in some words, we include everything, including, or we encrypt everything, including also header files. We're taking, of course, also a standard algorithm AES with 128 bit. And the key also here is derived from firm code and product code. So if we have a license entry with firm code 10, product code 1000, then we have one key in the dongle or in our license. And if we have one with a product code 1001, then we have a complete different key that we can use for encryption and for decryption. To be more accurate, we don't have one key. We have a lot of keys for every combination of firm code, product code. But to keep it simple, we have a different key for every product code. Let's say it in this simple words. Okay, we will insert our Vibu header. This is needed because when we encrypt a document, then the viewer needs to know, oh, which firm code, product code, so which license do I need? And so we enter information like, oh, this is an encrypted document. And by the way, we used firm code 10 and product code 1000. So if you have this license, then you can use this license, this key to decrypt the complete document. And what we also can do, we can say, we want to restrict the decryption to specific viewers. So let's say it's possible to see this in a Word viewer, or in a PowerPoint viewer, or a Navisworks viewer, which is called Freedom, by the way. But it should not be opened by Notepad or UltraEdit, because if you can open it with Notepad, then you can copy and paste it in a new document and save it without any problems. And that's why we say, okay, let's restrict it to some specific special viewers, and it should not be opened with other viewers. And last but not least, also here we support all license options, so all of our options like expiration time, unit counter, of course, can be used. So, and decryption. Also here we have our protected document. Now we have our document viewer, and Smart Shell SDL, secure data layer. And of course we have the license, either in a Kubernetes dongle or in a CMX license, or it could be on a server license, on a network server, in a local area network, wide area network, or in the cloud. But we have the license with firm code 10, product code 1000. And then the document is decrypted in the memory, so it will never be decrypted on the hard drive. The decrypted document is only in the memory. And of course, the decryption mode depends on some settings in AX Protector. So our Smart Shell SDL is a layer which is located between the viewer and the operating system. And so we are controlling every read and write operation from the viewer. And there are two ways to obtain this. One way is we take our viewer and we encrypt it with AX Protector and say, please make it compatible with file encryption. This is the easiest way. But of course, maybe due to legal questions, you're not entitled, you're not allowed to encrypt the viewer because you're modifying the viewer, and so we might not be do this due to legal reasons. And therefore, we have our Smart Shell SDL, and so you encrypt the dummy DLL, and this dummy DLL dynamic link library gets injected into the process, and then it's also a control layer between the operating system and the viewer. And so there are two ways. One way is encrypt the application or inject an encrypted DLL. So Smart Shell SDL verifies then if the valid license is there, so if the right firm code product code is available, and if it is available, it will decrypt the document in the memory, and so the user of course is not aware of the used encryption or decryption key, and the document is decrypted in the memory and so not on the hard drive. So we also check for unwanted programs. So we could do something like screenshot programs, like we already have heard from Stefan for the PDF document. So we check out if a snacket is running or something other, or if something prints the copy screen, print screen on the keyboard. And then we say either we disallow or we don't copy the data, so we collect the data and say sorry, we don't put it into the clipboard, or we will close the document immediately. Yeah, and Smart Shell SDL can also control if the viewer is able to write some data. And so we can say data could be written unencrypted, always encrypted, or we can say we will not allow writing. And this is something where you need to understand what does this viewer does. So technically we can put this layer, this SDL layer, around any type of viewer. We can also put it around a PDF, so Adobe PDF. But the thing is that of course from inside with the plugin you can control it better and easier than you're putting a layer around, because if you put a layer around you need to guess what happens inside. And so having this plugin for PDF is better than having a layer around PDF. But of course if you don't have a plugin, then this Smart Shell SDL would be a good choice. But you need to understand, does this viewer write some temporary data? Is it okay if this temporary data is encrypted or not? So if you say, writing forbidden, maybe the application will crash. And so you need to know something about the application you want to improve, make decryptable, able to decrypt some documents with Smart Shell SDL. Okay, so we also provide a dialogue for customizing error messages, and of course we also support all product item options, so all license options are supported. And maybe we should have a small demonstration. I prepared a small document, a TXT file. No, I will not copy it. I will just open it. So, and here we see it says, please protect me. And we want to protect this this file now. And that's why we start our AX protector. And I already prepared a small Vibu AX protector project. Let's open this. And what did I do? I just picked this document, this text.txt. And I said, okay, I want to encrypt it with firm code 6010 and product code 201000. And I said, okay, advanced options, nothing, and summary, please do it. So you see, encrypting something with AX Protector, encrypting a document is quite easy, quite simple. It has less options than, of course, for an application. And so now we have an encrypted document. It is located now in the folder protected. And let's take a look here. And if you see this document, we see now, oh, it's a binary file. And as I told you, we have this header from Vibu Systems, this Vibu BIF, Vibu binary file format with some header information. And then here we have the encrypted document. So you see, you cannot read anything. Yeah. So now when we want to take a view, I have this sample notepad, which is a part of our SDK. So it's a sample application, which is just, you can open some Word file or some text file. And let's say here I will open the unprotected version. The unprotected version, of course, can be opened. And if I try to open the protected version, protected text, then we will see that we get some Grümpfendrülpse. So we see nothing readable here, except of Vibu binary file format. Okay, so and therefore we will encrypt our application. Let's first start with the encrypted of the application. So we pick our sample notepad and we encrypt it with some firm code product code. We can choose the same, but we don't need to choose the same. So it's an option. And let's say, okay, we choose the same firm code product code combination. And then we jump through the dialogues. And one important thing, we need to turn off the static code modification because this is incompatible with our file encryption. And for this, later on, we say we will activate automatic file encryption. And that's it. That's it. I say, okay, finish. Now our application gets protected. It takes a few seconds to protect it because we are calculating a lot of challenge response pairs. We call this RID, required information decryption pairs, which are then stored in the application. And during the startup, we only take one of them. So startup is fast, but encryption takes a few time. So now let's start our sample notepad, the encrypted one. And we see here, I don't have a fitting license for this. I don't have a fitting license for this. We need a license. Therefore, we have a small demo page, lcqubemeter.com.demo. And here we say we want to have a license for our sample notepad. And by the way, I know that the sample notepad will use the right firm code product code combination. That's why I say create a demo ticket. I get a ticket. I want to store this into a soft license. The soft license, I will delete the old container which I have on my computer. I don't need it. And say, okay, it switched back to German. Okay, yeah. It automatically detects my browser. This is a feature, not a bug. And I say, okay, please activate selected licenses now. And in a few seconds, I will have a license for firm code 6010 and product code 201,000. Let's check. It is here. Yes, it is one local license. It is one local license. And maybe give me a second. We should check when we encrypted the text file. Here we are. Then I set normal user limit, so we need one license for the text file, we need a second license for the application. We have only one license, so this will bring us to an error message, and that's why I say please use the license also, but don't allocate the license. And so I will encrypt it with a no user limit vote, and so only the application will count, and the document only uses the same encryption decryption key, but it will not count as a second license. Okay, so and now when we start our protected application, now it starts, and now we will try to open the protected text. And when we open the protected text, then voila, ta 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 ta, we see please protect me, so we have decrypted our text file successfully. And if we don't have the fitting license, I will just have a new file. And what I can do here, I will return the license, so I will remove it from my computer, deactivate selected licenses now. So now the license is gone, and the license is gone and we cannot start our viewer. Okay, we need to activate the license once again because we need a license for the viewer, and we will decrypt the text file with a different firm code product code combination. So we will decrypt the file now with firm code and product code 101. And here we will just to show you that it's not a dirty trick with the user and no user limit. So the only thing I change is the product code 201001. That's more correct. So, and when we start the protected application now and we try to open the protected document, then we will see that we get an error message. Sorry, no license found. And we get a message that we cannot use it here. Cancel. Cancel. Okay, and the document is not decrypted. If we want to obtain the same with our SDL, in this case, I have prepared a small dummy DLL or CMSDL DLL. I have already encrypted this SDL DLL. I use the same things like I use or same settings I use for the application. So instead of encrypting our application, all I need to say, I want to encrypt our CMSDL DLL. As I told you, I already did it. And I will do the following thing. I have a small start program here, and with the start program, I say, okay, please start sample notepad first, the unprotected one, and then inject our protected DLL into the process of our sample notepad. Maybe it should be a good idea to have the right license here. We used the 2001, so I will create a new ticket for this one. And I now will activate licenses with the other product codes too. By the way, this is CodeMeter License Central, with which you can create a license, transfer a license to a user. So you create a ticket, send the ticket to the user, then the user can activate a license quite easy and simple. And when we take a look here in CodeMeter Web Admin, then we will see that we now have also the product code 201001. So, and now let's go back to our start SDL. So now we started the unprotected application. We have not injected the DLL, so we just will open or try to open the protected text, and so it will fail because the viewer doesn't know anything about, so no error message, nothing, no decryption. And now we will inject our DLL, and after the injection, now the player can decrypt the protected file because we have the right license. And we have now injected the DLL, and so in this case we did not need to change the viewer. So we could use this Freedom Viewer for Navisworks. We could use a Word Viewer, PowerPoint Viewer, Excel Viewer. So we could use any viewer and then just start a viewer and then inject our DLL, and then we can decrypt our documents. Yeah, and that's it. That's how document protection with standard documents works.
If we are talking about standard documents, immediately the Word format come into my mind. How about that, Rüdiger? Is that possible?
Technically, yes. But let's take a look. So because with Word you can also write documents. And so with Smart Shelter SDL, we are able to control writing files. So we're not only able to control reading files, we can only control writing files. And if an application like Word wants to create a new file, could really be a new file, like save as, could be a file new, something like this, could be a temp file, nobody knows what they're doing. We can say, okay, either you change it to unencrypted, writing forbidden, so writing not allowed, or to encrypted. And so the important setting is, what should happen if a new file is created? The second thing is, what should be done if an existing file is changed? Should a condition maintain? So if it is encrypted, it should be encrypted. If it is not encrypted, unencrypted, it should also stay unencrypted. Or do we say, oh, also for existing files, we forbid writing or don't allow writing? Or should it be every time encrypted? And so there you can define some rules in Smart Shelter SDL, what you can do with the document in case of writing. The other thing is, we can also, so our injection DLL could say, oh, we will monitor every copy and paste, so control C and control V. And then we could grab this thing from the clipboard and remove it and say, oh, you are not allowed to copy anything. And so with this DLL, we can control, yes, copy and paste is always allowed or always forbidden. So these are the two operation options that we have. But unfortunately, Smart Shelter SDL doesn't know the context of the application. So is it a control, a copy-paste action with this protected document, or is it a copy-paste action with a completely new document? Is it a save as operation with a complete new document, or is it a save as from the existing document, which should be protected? And so the thing is, we cannot control copy-paste and save as for one special document. We can only say, yes, this application now, Word, is allowed for copy-paste, yes or no, and it's allowed for save document with a different name, so save as. And so if you say, no, you're not allowed to copy paste, you're not allowed to save as after opening and protect the document, this would mean, let's have a small sample. Let's assume Stefan opens up a protected document, and then he closes the document, but he keeps Word open, and Word is now in this protected mode. And now Stefan says, oh, I will write a new article for Keynote, because next Keynote I read to write an article about this Smart Shelter PDF, and then Stefan will start writing. Stefan will start writing for 1 hour, for 2 hours, for 3 hours, and after 3 hours he tries to save, and then he gets a message, sorry, you're not allowed to save because you're in this encrypted mode, or you can encrypt your document, but you're not allowed to to save your document now, your own document. And so this is exactly the challenge that we have here by protecting Word documents, that technically it's possible. But from the business processes, it's not easy to implement. And so technically, it's possible. And if you say strong protection, it's mostly doesn't fit to the business process. And if you say, okay, we allow copy-paste, then the protection renders useless. And so having something with writing documents, standard documents, technically, yes, but mostly in most cases, it doesn't work from the requirements.
Okay, let's talk about now own documents. So if we talk about documents, we are not only talk about real documents only for reading. So we collected some of our use cases that we have in our daily work. And for example, we have the music recording software. So the requirement of the software is they should always run and record music. So let's assume we have a concert of Peter Gabriel. It is absolutely necessary that the software records the concert, even if there is no license, for example, or someone has forgot the dongle. So it has to be work in any case. But the recorded music at the end should only be accessible with a valid license, for example, in the studio later on when they have to mixture all the channels of the recorded tracks. Another use case is demo versions. So the requirement is my demo version can do anything, but it should not be possible to save files. That save files cannot be opened, and no files may be saved. These are two requirements for that use case. And another use case is an individual configuration file. So my customer are not allowed to exchange configuration files to change that. So these are three use cases, and we have another three use cases as well.
Just more words to this individual configuration file. So I have some clients which are saying, okay, I'm selling my software and then I'm doing some special configuration for one special customer, and I don't want that this customer is giving this to another customer because I want to sell this configuration files. And so I want this customer to use it. They can also change it, but they should not be able to exchange this configuration files with other customers. Yeah, another use case is that we have some customers, clients, which want to protect the data of the user. So let's say the user is an, let's say just someone who creates a blueprint for this laser cutting machine. And then this blueprint should be protected. Or let's assume that your user is Coca-Cola, and so they use your machine to produce Coke, and so they need to use the secret Coke formula, so 100% water plus 100% sugar, something like this. Okay, but so another use case. Let's assume you have some partner business and your software does, you have a machine and this machine does some laser cutting, and then you want to allow your user that he can create these NC files which control the cutting with your own software or with software from authorized partner, but they should not be created with software made from somebody else. And if you the CAD partner and you want to partner with this machine vendor, then maybe you want to say it in a different way, that that only data which is or just that your data can only be used on a machine where the fitting license is. And so in both directions you can make sure that it only works if the license is there for this partnering. So, and here we have the solution. We have our cryptographic toolset, top of breed cryptographic toolset. And we provide a secure key storage for symmetric keys and for private keys for asymmetric encryption, decryption and signature. And so what we have four different solution approaches. One is a common symmetric key for all. This could be used if you want to sell documents, and every user who purchased the same document should get the same key, which means just get the same firm code, product code. Remember, different product code, different key, same product code, same key. Or one individual symmetric key for everyone. So let's imagine the sample with our configuration data, and I don't want my users to exchange this this data, and so we have individual keys. Or we can have an asymmetric key pair for encrypting some things, or an asymmetric key pair for making signatures. And that's why I prepared copied a few slides from our basic cryptographic webinar. And here let's just speak about symmetric encryption. And in this key we have a shared key, so the same secret key on both sides from the sender and from the recipient. And we take some data, we take the shared key and we encrypt the data. And on the other side, the encrypted data can be decrypted, of course, with the same shared key. So, and how does this work? So the key could be transferred or created via license entry, so firm code, product code. So just selling this firm code, product code, sending this ticket over, and then using License Central to activate it into a dongle or a soft license, quite easy and simple. So all users who should use the same document will get, of course, the same key. If you have groups of documents or groups of features, then you can, of course, assign them to different product codes. So let's say you have one type of documents which are for registered users, so for everybody. Next one is for paying clients. The next one, next group of documents is for your partners. The next one for your own service technicians. And so let's say we take product code 1000 for the registered users, 1001 for the paying clients, 1002 for the partners, and 1003 for our internal service employees. And so then we can say, okay, our service employee gets all four product codes, and so he can decrypt all of the documents, and the registered user gets only the product code 1000, and so it can only decrypt documents which were protected with product code 1000. So a typical use cases is here software or content that we sell, so not just only software but also content, and of course protection of configuration files if we speak of this user groups or individual users which have individual licenses. If we have an individual symmetric key for everyone, yeah, then we create one individual key, and we can do it either if you take one separate license entry for every user. So we create one license entry of License Central for every user, so a different product code. Or we can take the same product code but choose randomly or take use randomly chosen, created, secret or hidden data entries in a firm code, product code combination, which means we have an individual symmetric key for every user. And of course you can say, ah, I will allow my user to purchase, get his own firm code, and then he can create his own user-specific key in his own firm code. So it's not only limited to your firm code, you can also allow your customers, your users, to use their own firm codes. And use cases here is mainly the individually protected configuration files, so a different key for every user, and of course also protection of users' data, so this Coke formula with the one part sugar and one part water. Asymmetric encryption or asymmetric decryption. In this case, we have a public and a private key pair, and the private key is at the side of the recipient. The sender has the public key of this recipient, so of this key pair which belongs together. And private key is something the recipient should keep private, so it's its own property, nobody should know it, and public key means everybody can know it, everybody can get it. And there we have some data. We decrypt, we encrypt the data using the public key, and then we get some encrypted data. So everyone can encrypt data, but only the one who is the owner of this private key can decrypt the data later on. And so what we will see, this is the use case of our Peter Gabriel concert. So everybody or the software can encrypt every time, the whole day, without license, the software can encrypt the data of the concert, but only with the fitting license in the CodeMeter dongle is possible to decrypt the data and use it later on in the studio. And the question is how to create such a key pair. The key pair can be created, and then the private key can be stored securely in the container. So you as the manufacturer or vendor, you can create this key pair, which if you take a cryptographic book, then you will find out, oh, this is the wrong way, because then you know the key pair, but you should not be able to, or you should not know the key pair. The key pair is something that should be created by the user himself. But if the user creates the key pair, then the process is more complex. And so in the real world, both options has their charm. So the manufacturer, you create a key pair, it's a simple process. The user creates a key pair, so it's more secure from the book or from the university view of cryptographic, how to use cryptographic mechanisms, but the other one is more simple, and so both are used, of course. The public key needs to be known in the system, and for this, the one option is to have a mini certificate with a root key. So we have a root key pair, and with the root key, you will sign this public key, and then you need only to publish the root public key in the application, and so the root public key could be hard coded in the application. And of course, this mini certificate needs to be signed with an individual root key. So at the end, we are using the same, or you can use the same mechanisms. We're offering the same mechanisms like there are in X509 certificates, but with this mini certificate, it's more handy, more smaller, it's faster, and it's easier to handle if you have a mini certificate and not this standard certificate. So it's the same standard mechanism, but of course, in an easier way. Yeah, encryption with an asymmetric key pair. The encryption with the public key is possible always, and the decryption only with the fitting key. And the use cases, I have a demo version, trial version, and we encrypt the data, but only with the fitting license. Later on, you should be able to use the data, and of course, this music recording software. And if you say the data may only be processed by the software of an authorized partner who has the correct license, which means I will encrypt the data with the public key of this partner, and then only the software of the partner has the right private key in the license, only the software is able to decrypt the data and to use the data. And so I can make sure that the data which I created can only be used in the software which I authorized for the usage of my data. And the other way around, a signature. In case of a signature, the sender has the private key and the recipient has the public key. And here I first create a hash of the data and then I will sign this hash. So from a data of any size, I will create a hash with a fixed size and then I will sign this, this hash value. And so I have data and signature. And then I send this data and signature to the recipient. And the recipient, of course, will also create a hash first. And then he will check with the public key, is the signature valid, yes or no? And then he can decide if he will use this data or if he will say, no, this data is not the right data, it's not authorized, and so I will not use this data. The creation of this asymmetric key pair is similar to the creation for encryption. So encryption and signature using the same mechanisms for the creation of the key pair, that's why the slide isn't animated. And so if we have a signature with an asymmetric key pair, then the signature can only be created if the fitting private key is available. Everyone can check the signature using the public key. The authentication, if the public key is the right public key, can be done using this mini certificate. And the use cases are protection of data against tampering. So we can sign data and then this data cannot be modified. This is one use case. The second use case is, for instance, if you have an journal of the so machine or engine journal and we want to make sure that this is not changed, not altered. So we have some samples where fisher with their ships, and they fang some fish, and each day they need to write down on the log book on the journal how many they have they catched, and at the end this journal then is an electronic journal, so it is signed and is transferred to a server, and so later on it's not nobody is able to manipulate this data in the journal. And last but not least, the use case that was on the slide already from the beginning, that only data from an authorized partner is processed. And so I have my software and I need to sign the data, and the machine only uses data which was correctly signed, and so I can make sure with this that it was all this data was produced with my own software or with a software of an authorized partner, and otherwise I say sorry, no, I'm not allowed to use this data because this data comes from an unauthorized source. Yeah, and we've seen that we have this APIs, and for this I have a small demonstration. Let's go to our CodeMeter API guide, and here we have the basic functions that we use for this encryption and decryption of some code. And the first one is we say we want to access firm code and product code, so we need to get a handle to a key. Firm code 6010, product code 201000. And say okay, we want to get a handle, and then we get a message, everything is fine, everything is okay, no error occurred. So, and here we see the code that we need to copy to our application, and this code can be created in C, C++, .NET, so C Sharp, Java, Delphi, also for Visual Basic, .NET, if you're programming Visual Basic. And so it can be created for any, for most of the common programming languages. And then here we have the encryption and decryption functionality. And let's say we want to encrypt our code or number, let's say 0314, and then we can encrypt this using this handle, and then we get a result which is 8BDF and so on. Copy and paste, we paste it here, and then we can of course decrypt it, and at the end our 314 should be seen here. And so this is how to encrypt and decrypt some data using a firm code and product code. And then we have some APIs for this asymmetric encryption, and in this case we're using a public key for the encryption. So here we have the public key and our data, and then we can encrypt our data. And for the decryption we have our CMcrypt, and in CMcrypt we have here the option that we use ACES, so this asymmetric method for decrypting some data. And for signatures we have a special API which we have calculate digest for creating this hash value, then calculate a signature for creating a signature, validate a signature for checking if the signature is valid, and get public key, so if you have a private key in a dongle or in a soft license and you want to obtain or get the public key, then we can call get public key to get our public key. And I have prepared a small application encryption API which shows you how it works. And for this let's just open this small project. It's written in C#, so .NET project, and I implemented two functions, the button encrypt click and the button decrypt click. If we take a deeper look, then we see that the code is a lot of code is twice here, and so of course we can improve it a little bit. But what we do is we first calling a CM access, so we have getting a handle to a firm code and product code. And I see there's a mistake. I need to, of course, fill this first because before I have this CM access. So this was the challenge for this webinar to change this here. Okay, so now I have an access. And if I get an access, then we will encrypt some data using this access, and later on we can, with the decrypt button, we can decrypt it. And here I'm using the same firm code product code that we used in the demo already now. And let's compile our code, and so we have a text. This is a text. Let's say, hello Stefan. Hello. Hello Steve. And now we will encrypt our text. Hello Steve. Blah, 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 blah. We will encrypt our text, and then we get our encrypted Steve. And when we decrypt it, then we get our decrypted byte buffer, and here we get the message, hello Steve, and our Grümpfentyp that they added at the end. If you ask the question, why didn't it work at the first try. That's quite easy because the minimum length that we use in our API is 16 bytes. And so the string that we or the data that we want to encrypt needs to be at least a 16 byte. If your data is shorter, then of course there are some padding methods which I did not implement in my simple sample. But what you see here is you can use CodeMeter quite easily, so just a few lines of code to use our encryption and decryption mechanism. And with this, I think it's time for a short summary.
Yes, sure. Thank you very much, Rüdiger. So let's see. We showed in our webinar how to protect PDF files, so higher protection standards with Smart Shelter PDF. This is the product we offer for you. We have as a second topic standard documents, so an easy integration into a viewer is possible, and the higher integration comes with the Smart Shelter SDL this way. Rüdiger gave you the information about integration into an Office application only under certain conditions, so there are some limitations, we have seen that before. And last but not least, proprietary documents, use of the CodeMeter API that Rüdiger shows us some seconds before, and there's a variety of applications where you can use that for your own purposes. So now we have reached the end of the webinar. Thank you very much for your attention. Let's see what questions do we have in our queue. One question is, where do I get the software for the PDF reader, the Smart Shelter PDF reader form? This is very easy because we have prepared an installation package for your customers. So this is downloadable from our website, and there's everything your customer needs, software to have the plugin for the Adobe Reader ready to go.
I see there's a second question in the chat. How much does Smart Shelter PDF cost? So I think you as the key account manager, what does it cost?
Yeah, this is the best thing. This Smart Shelter PDF is included in the standard package of CodeMeter. So there are no additional costs for you. If you are a CodeMeter customer, you can use Smart Shelter PDF in addition to the normal technology that we offer for you. Yes, and that's all. We have reached our time limit. Thank you very much again for your attention and for your time, and have a good day wherever you are in the world, and hope to hear and see you in with our next webinar session.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you also from my side, and have a nice morning, day, evening. Bye-bye, and I hope you will hear from us soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Rüdiger, and thank you, Stefan, for the very interesting conversation, and a special thanks to all of our attendees. We hope you enjoyed this masterclass as much as we did. Remember to answer the short quiz as soon as we close this session for your chance to win an Amazon coupon worth 50 euro. Our next mail with a link to the recording and the slide deck will be with you in a couple of days. That's all, folks, for today. See you next month for a new engaging topic. Have a bright day.